let me say. And it's good that you've gathered yourself here with us. Brother Daniel's going to make a few announcements, and after that, we'll get started.
I tried to do that quickly. It did not work. We have a few things coming up, and we're so glad to have you with us this morning as we meet together to worship. Next Saturday, we have a wedding shower for Sten Laracy, as well as his fiancée, and that'll be in the social hall at 10:30. On the 28th, 2 weeks from today, we'll have an afternoon event for our children up to fifth grade. It's a spring fling. There's an opportunity for some of you all that would like to help out with that, with some games and stuff, to sign up. We'd love to have you be a part of that as well. We have a community sale, yard sale we're going to do to help our community. We're going to try to do it for them and then use what we get from it to bless them as well. So if you'd like to donate to that, there's information in there. We would like to celebrate our graduates this year. So if you have a student graduating from high school or college, let's begin to get that information in so we can celebrate their achievements. And there's a ladies' Bible study starting this week. You still have an opportunity to sign up for, and just want to encourage you to be a part of those things. It's good to see you this morning as Brother Mike begins to lead us.
Let's get started with the music by praising him and giving him the glory. I'm going to ask you to remain seated, and we'll praise him together in four songs as Lisa plays. Good to see each and every one of you.
To God be the glory, great things he had done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who lived in his life, made atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, let the people
congregation. I know many of you have been through many things this past year, and some even this last week. And I see as you're worshiping that you're just thankful to be here. So let's give him praise for the little things that might not seem as big to others, but they're very big. And let's give him praise for those big things he's taken us through in life as well. And let's do it as we just did in song, but in our walk and our talk as well. As we continue to sing, we're going to encourage you through this song to rely on Jesus for all things. He's been with you through different things, and he's going to continue being with you. He's never left the throne, and he's stronger than ever.
There is love that came for us, humble to a sinner's cross. He paid my shame and sinfulness. He rose again victorious. Faithfulness none can deny. Through the storm and through the fire, there is truth that sets me free. Christ, who lives in me. You are strong.
Just thinking of two kids in my band that just don't know Christ. And matter of fact, they actually would say they're an atheist, two out of 175. And but, you know, I had an opportunity this past week, and I just prayed that seeds were planted. But I'm thinking about those kids, and I'm feeling for them and what their belief is. And you can see confusion. You can see just they just lack direction, a lot of them. And so you pray for these kids with me this week, if you will, if you think about that. And there's people out there, they don't really know what they believe. They're just lost. They may think they're this, or they may think they're this. That's just confusion, and we know that comes from the devil. So you'll pray with me then with these kids, and may they be exposed to the good word through songs and through the scripture this week and the upcoming weeks. Let's stand. Take a look around you to the left and the right. It's always a pleasure more than ever coming to church now, because you just don't know who's going to show up and be able to come back. So as we're growing in number again, let's be mindful to be careful as we just fellowship this way. But it's a pleasure to see each and every one of you. We're going to read scripture together, okay? So we're going to read from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 11, verses 28 through 30. Read along with me. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Amen to the reading of God's word. You may be seated. God wants you to come just as you are, just as you, when you came to know him as your Savior, as Christians. He wants you to come and continue to pour blessings upon him as we lift his name and give him the glory, but also to pour your burdens upon him. Give your burdens up to the Lord. And we want to sing Just As I Am. Sing with the ladies.
Just as I am.
By the blood of Christ, the Lamb.
chorus with us. I come broken.
I come broken to be mended. I come wounded to be healed. I come desperate to be rescued. I come empty to be filled. I come guilty to be pardoned by the blood of Christ the Lamb. And I'm welcome with open arms, praise God, just as I am. Praise God, just as
thank you for praising him in music, and we're going to praise him in a prayer.
You know, as the song was saying, we come empty to be filled. But you'd think, you know, I don't come empty. I come filled. You do not come filled. If you live in this world today, you can get empty in a hurry, because it is a bad, bad world to live in. But it's the only world we got. And so we want to do that. We want to praise God for it. And we want to praise God for what he's doing. What he's doing, we don't know. But we will find out later on. I thank you, Lord, for your blessings. And as Mike had mentioned, he'd got two into the choir, Lord, into the band. Lord, that profess not to be Christians, but profess to be atheists. Lord, as we pray this week, that will be changed. Because I know, Lord, it can be done, because all the people around and all the people here put it on their hearts, Lord, to pray for them daily that, Lord, this will be changed, because such a young people and what they could do to fill this world with the glory that they have. We ask you, Lord, to bless us today. Lord, as we come, Lord, fill us and fill us fully, because, Lord, we know that you're the one that can do it. We ask you, Lord, for your blessings as we leave here today, too. But right now, Lord, we are here, and we want to praise you and give you thanks and give you honor for everything that's going on in the life of our lives. Amen.
Amen. We've taken an old hymn and kept the melody, and we put a different arrangement with it. And we hope, we want you to sing with us. This is not a special. Crown him with many crowns in the first verse. Crown him with many crowns, the Lord upon his throne. So, as I look in the congregation, I know many of you have been through so many things. War, famine, epidemic, loss of life in your family. You've been through so much. But one thing remains constant. He's on his throne. And so we're going to sing together, Crown Him with Many Crowns.
Music.
sways. From pole to pole that wars may cease, and all be prayer and praise. His reign shall know no end, and round his pierced feet the flowers of paradise extend their fragrance ever sweet. Around him the Lord of Lords, behold his hands and side. Those wounds yet visible above in beauty glorified. All hail, O Redeemer, hail, for thou hast died for me. Thy praise and glory shall not fail throughout eternity.
First Corinthians chapter 15. Brother, that was my problem. I apologize. First Corinthians chapter 15, the last few weeks now, I've been preaching on the subject of seeing Jesus. Seeing Jesus. If you have been with us over these weeks, you know that we have saw in Daniel chapter 3, verse 25, what we have saw, first of all, is Jesus as seen by Nebuchadnezzar. It was a theophany, an Old Testament appearance of the Lord Jesus Christ. And in that passage, it says, he answered and said, "Lo, I see four men loose, walking in the midst of the fire. They have no hurt, and the form of the fourth is like unto the Son of God." That's what Nebuchadnezzar, let me say, that's who Nebuchadnezzar saw. We also have saw in Acts chapter 7, verse 55, that Stephen saw Jesus. He says there in chapter 7, 55, "But he, being full of the Holy Ghost, looked up steadfastly into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing on the right hand of God." We saw in Luke chapter 19 where Zacchaeus saw Jesus. Zacchaeus heard that Jesus was coming through Jericho. Zacchaeus said, "I want to see Jesus." And he went, and the crowd was so large that he could not get a front row seat. So he climbed up the tree. And the scripture says in Luke chapter 19 verse 5, "And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said unto him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must abide at thy house." Also, we have saw where two disciples on the road to Emmaus saw Jesus. That was where we preached from last week. And the passage there yields itself in Luke 24, 31. And it says, "And their eyes were open, and they knew him as he vanished out of their sight." About 3 weeks ago, we saw where Herod saw Jesus. Luke chapter 23, verse 8 said, "And when Herod saw Jesus, he was exceeding glad, for he was desirous to see him of a long season, because he had heard many things of him, and he hoped to have seen some miracle done by him." What you discover there is Jesus has appeared to many people. We find that, yes, he was evidently appearing to people as he had his earthly ministry. But even beyond that, the cross and the resurrection, and then even after the ascension, what we find is Jesus were appearing to some of these people that we have noted, okay? Now, I'm not asking you today, but if he has, I'd sure like to know it at some point. If you have saw Jesus, maybe you say, "I had a dream, I had a vision, I saw Jesus." But what we see in these passages is not dreams and visions. We see literal appearances of the Lord Jesus. One of my favorite passages comes out of John chapter 12, verse 20. It said, "There were certain Greeks among them who came to worship at the feast. And the same came therefore to Philip, which was of Galilee, and desired him, saying, Sir, we would see Jesus. And Philip cometh and telleth Andrew, and again Andrew and Philip tell Jesus. What a popular man. Let me tell you something, friend. He's more than a popular man, okay? He is the Savior. He is God incarnate. He, the Scripture tells us, is Emmanuel, God with us. I find it increasingly important as I read through the Scriptures. I don't have to search real hard, but the Holy Spirit of God gives us recall concerning those various people and places where folks have seen Jesus. Oh, today I would remind you that people need a fresh glimpse of Jesus. I really believe He's the answer to where we are. I will get more specific. I believe He's the answer to where you are and I am as well. We are going to read in a moment Paul's writing to the Corinthian believer. And Paul is writing to the Corinthians now, and he had spent about 18 months with them in ministry. But what we find now is he is writing to them concerning a time when he had sought Jesus himself. Now, that's covered in Acts chapter 9. And yet I like what he tells the Corinthians even as he would talk about him seeing Jesus. So we're reading verses 1 through 4 in the beginning here of 1 Corinthians 15. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also you have received, and wherein you stand, by which also you are saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried, and that He arose again the third day according to the Scriptures. Oh, what we have is a brief paragraph, or a portion of a paragraph, of Paul's writings now to the Corinthians, of whom I shared with you a little earlier. He had shared 18 months with them in an earthly ministry. But now as he is writing back to correct some issues that were going on in the Corinthian church, Paul includes this in the narration of chapter 15, or might I say this section, for there wasn't a chapter when it was written. What Paul does here, I believe, is gives a practical view of Christ, or let me say, the Christ. Now to us, He is what He said in John 1 and 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. If you were in that small group Bible study this morning that is studying through Bible Studies for Life, you remember that's the passage we were teaching this morning for a few moments there. Now, we see the practical view of the Christ. Paul has not stated yet that he had seen Jesus. But let me tell you, you can look down in that chapter and we'll read it as well in just a few moments. And we'll see there where he says about him, his own self having seen Jesus. So what will he give us here? I call it a practical view of the Christ, the gospel. The Bible would mention the word gospel on various occasions. Paul would use it in Romans 1 and 16 where he'd say, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it is the salvation of God unto those who believe, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. I'm glad to tell you today that Jesus, as we see Him, Paul would write to the Corinthians and he would mention about the Christ and sin. Notice, he says there, in these verses there, I delivered first of all, I'm in verse 3, I delivered first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scripture. Friend, let me tell you a little secret here. You're not going, and none of us who have received Christ, but the reality is this, it is not plural sins that cause people to go to hell. It's literally a single sin that causes people to be lost and without, and that is the rejection of Jesus. Now, those who are without sometime would like to compare lists of sins, wouldn't they? Now, friend, let me just say, I don't like to get in lists there. But Paul uses the word in a plural form when he says that Christ died for our sins. You might be here today and you might say, hey, I believe He could forgive me of everything I've ever done. But there's that one thing that I don't know about. Let me say something to you about Jesus. If He cannot forgive for all sins, He will not forgive for any sin. But Paul said He died for our sins. Now, Paul has seen Jesus. We'll get to it in a moment. But before he ever tells them that I have seen Him, he begins to talk to them about Him. Now, there's some portions of various letters that are already circulating that had been written in what we now know as the canonization of the New Testament. Paul, though, is writing, and some would suppose that Paul was converted about the year of A.D. 31 to 36, somewhere in that span of years. Ladies and gentlemen, I'll go ahead and tell you what the emphasis is on, and that is that when Paul saw Jesus, he would say, what shall I do, or where shall I go? He calls Him Lord there. I was thinking this week, I was studying the last couple of days particularly, and let me just tell you, Paul was a believer. He was a believer in God. And then he came to the Damascus experience there on the road to Damascus, and he became a believer in Jesus. So maybe you're saying to me today, Pastor, I'm a believer. But the reality is we need to understand fully what we believe. Well, notice he talks about the Christ, the sin. Then he would talk about the sight. If you would read Paul's conversion experience, it is covered in various places. The best probably is Acts chapter 9. You could find it mentioned in smaller portions in various other places. But you know the blinding light experience. You know how there he was led into Damascus. You know how God moved in the heart of Ananias there. And the Scripture tells us that God said, hey, Ananias, don't be afraid of him. He's a chosen vessel unto me to carry forth the gospel to the Gentiles. Well, the reality of that is the sin. God gave him back his sight after he was blinded those days, 3 days. And then there's what I call the sign there. And last, there's the substitute. I'm proud to tell you today that Jesus did for me what I could not do for myself. I could never have atoned for my own sin. Matter of fact, I would never even try to imagine how many or certain things that if we could do them in order to be right with God, what would He require of us? Oh, I'm here to tell you, there's a practical view of the Christ. You know, we've been known from time to time to try to study a prophetic view of Christ, taking Genesis 1 all the way to Malachi and try to look at that prophetic view of Christ all through the Old Testament books. Friend, but you know, that doesn't suffice what we need today. We need a fresh view of the living Christ. Well, I told you about Nebuchadnezzar and Stephen and Zacchaeus and the two disciples, and I told you about Herod. Oh, but let's think today that we need to see Jesus as well. Notice, not only a practical view, but there's a panoramic view of the witnesses. Oh, notice, if you would, if your Bible is open, verses 5 to 7. This is not an exhaustive list of those who saw Jesus after His resurrection. This is a portion of those who would have saw Him. I tried to find it in a concise view that I might could have put it on a PowerPoint slide for you today to see. but that there were many. But notice these that he does give us witness of. He would tell us in verse number 5, he was seen of Cephas, the 12. He was seen above 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this day, but some are fallen asleep. He was seen of James, then of all the apostles. How many of you remember in the New Testament, I think it's in Matthew, that talks about by the mouth of two or three witnesses something could be established? Well, notice there's great many more witnesses than that he's giving us here. So Paul now is telling them, look at this panoramic view of these witnesses. Well, I was sharing with the church in the early service this morning. There was a time when we were living in Florida that one of the girls got to go to Washington on a trip. Debbie went with her. And it was for the safety patrol. Now, naturally, you know, Floridians have all the money, but we still had to pay for the trip. But yet they went and had a great time. Now, what I know about that trip was the picture they brought back to show me. And the picture was a panoramic view of all of those people that were with them on that tour. And they pointed out to me, now, if you look at this panoramic view, you look at this man right here on the left side. And I looked at that man and said, now, hey, look over on the right side of that picture. And what we had there was that same guy who literally had outran the camera and he had got on that side. Now, I'm from South Georgia. And I was born after cameras were invented, but I don't know how that happened. He was either fast or the camera was slow. You know, the panoramic view of something sometimes is unexplainable. However, sometimes we need to maintain a closeness, something that we can see. And friend, I'm not telling you we need a photograph of this on your wall in your house. But we need a fresh view of this in our heart and life of who Jesus is. If you would ask Peter or Cephas, you might get various other descriptive words about Jesus. If you were to ask the 12, and we know at this particular time, there were 11 after the resurrection. They did replace Judas with Matthias, but we don't know that that's the 12 he's talking about. Some are supposing that that was just a literal term for the apostles, 12, you know. However, about 500 of them at once. Boy, that would have been a meeting, wouldn't it? And then there was James, a family member that saw Jesus after the resurrection, prior to the ascension, and then all of the apostles. Friend, I want to tell you something. It is special when you see Jesus. It will change your life tremendously. Now, with all of that in mind, I want us to go to the third place today, and that is a personal view of himself. It was well that Paul gives us a panoramic view of the witnesses. I'm all right with the fact, and I'm excited for the fact there, that he gives us an overview there in those first verses of a practical view of the Christ. But I believe this is my most important heart of this chapter, and that is that personal view of himself. Look at verse 8. And last of all, he was seen of me also. That's the evidence I have to point you to that Paul met Jesus. Last of all, he was seen of me also as of one born out of due time. For I am the least of the apostles, that I am not meet to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. Now, if you go back and you read the account in Acts chapter 9, what you're going to see is that Paul now, in Acts chapter 9, on the day there that he was traveling to Damascus, he was blinded by blinding light. The scripture said in that blinding light, he would say something like this, Lord, what would thou have me do? Now, The Lord would tell him to go into Damascus, and there would a man meet him there. And it worked out just like the Lord said it. And then Paul would receive back his sight. Now, I'm not going to go into all that happened with Saul after that, to change his name to Paul. Went into Arabia. He met Jesus. I'm not going to all that, but he said he was seen of me also. From time to time, I hear people in their little small groups talking. Sometimes it's in the hallway in the back. Sometimes it's in the fellowship hall around the table. But they'd say something like, "You can't believe who I saw the other day." Now, my name has never been included in that, but you can't believe who I saw the other day. You've met some important people, I'm sure. But friend, I'll tell you, there's never a person who changes our life like Jesus does. I remember when I was a junior in high school. Now, yeah, that was in the 70s still. That's hard to believe. But yet, I remember when I first saw my wife there. Oh, I saw her, and she had curly hair, black. She wore glasses like I'm wearing today, you know. But, wow, I thought, that is a beautiful woman. Some guy's going to be lucky. And, oh, I got the pick of the litter. And I'm telling you, I just think about having seen her. Now, she'd been in the hallway, but I saw her differently that time. Let me tell you something about Jesus. You've probably been hearing about Him all your life, maybe. Some of you have probably been in a worship center since before you were born, like I were myself. But let me tell you something. When you see Jesus, as the songwriter said, what a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. Let's see what Paul says about his personal view concerning himself. When he saw Jesus, first of all, he would make a statement. He would say, "For I'm the least of the apostles. I'm not meet to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God." Some believe that this writing was somewhere around 56 A.D. I'm not sure. It doesn't really matter to me when Paul made that statement. But it is after he met Jesus. Oh, friend. Can you say, or maybe you would think, that you are the least of apostles? I'm not playing with the word apostles. I don't want to abuse that. But I'm just giving you Paul's view of himself after he saw Jesus. He said, "I'm the least of all the apostles." He wanted the Corinthians to fully understand, did he not, that he was not the one to be worshipped, for he was a worshiper. Now, if you'll go back and read it in the context of chapter 3 of 1 Corinthians, what you would learn is there were already divisions of people. One's, "I'm of Paul, I'm of Apollos, I'm..." Notice, he said, "I'm the least of the apostles." Now, friend, if you have read your New Testament, you know that 13, maybe 14 of the books of the New Testament were attributed to being written by Paul. But Paul, in light of Jesus and his seeing him, would say this, "I'm the least of the apostles and not even meet to be called an apostle." Sort of reminds me of Isaiah chapter 6. You remember when Isaiah saw God? When Isaiah saw God, what did he say? "I am a man of unworthy lips," let me say. "I'm a God that is not even worthy to be here." He saw the thrice holy God. And then when the Spirit and the Father said, "Whom shall we send and who'll go for us?" Isaiah said, "Here am I, send me." Paul not only said that he was the least of the apostles. Paul tells us in 1 Timothy 1:15, he said, "This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief." Two things. You may not remember the entire verse, but remember that Paul said, first of all, "I'm the least of the apostles." Now he is telling Timothy, as he writes him later, he said, "I am the chief of sinners." Now, friend, let me tell you something about being a sinner. If you have came to know Jesus and you have confessed your sin to Him privately, if you have followed Him obediently, let me tell you something. You don't need to look back on your sin and try to carry it as a load, because it's all forgiven. Paul is not saying that I feel every day I beat myself down for my previous sin. But he's saying I still have to recognize that in my life I've been the chief of sinners. Now, he could have thought back that day that Stephen was being stoned to death, could he? Because you know whose feet it was where they laid their coats? It was this guy that's writing. Paul might not have thrown a rock at Stephen, but Paul said, I'm sinners of sinners, I'm chief. Paul not only said that, but in the third place, in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 8, says, unto me, who am the least of all the saints, is this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. Do you know, meeting Jesus will change you. Seeing Jesus changed Paul, did it not? Paul was a devout Hebrew. Paul had been educated under the best of all scholars when it came to Judaism. But let me tell you something. That is not what changed Paul. What changed him is seeing Jesus. And friend, I want to tell you something. The Lord is still in the changing business. Boy, if we could just get people to Jesus. For Paul said, in my case, I'm the least of the apostles. In my case, I'm the chief of sinners. And in my case, of all the saints in the world at that time, he said, I'm the least of them. Some would say Paul had a bad complex. No, Paul had a good understanding. I don't find Paul promoting himself anywhere to you. But he said, I'm chief. I close with this last verse, and it's verse 10. And this verse 10 again says, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. Now you say, preacher, do you use that very often? No. Some people can use that as a cop-out. When they have not lived their lives faithfully since they've met Jesus, they can just say, hey, well, I am what I am. You've probably done the best you can do, but why don't you surrender yourself to Jesus, for He'll change your life completely. And that's where He says, by the grace of God, I am what I am. And His grace which bestowed upon me, it wasn't in vain. In other words, it's been a good investment. He said, I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God which was in me. Folks, as you think about it in closing today, this is only one man whose life was dramatically changed by one other man. But the one other man happened to be the God-man, Jesus. My life has been changed in ways by other men, and I'm sure yours has. Sometimes I think about all the old pastors I had. And all, you say, preacher, can you remember all of them? Absolutely. Everyone except one is deceased. And sometimes I just take my pencil down and write a note to him, say, hey, man, thank you for those years. You know why? Because there's some men have helped to change my life. But I'll tell you something. Jesus is the one who made the great change. Would you see Jesus? I don't have a picture of him to put forth to you. I have a word picture. But yet and still, Jesus makes the change. As you bow your heads with me today, could I ask you, if Jesus hasn't made a change in your life, what is hindering you from allowing Him to? Oh, preacher, I know somebody who really needs to be changed. Let's make sure that we're changed first, and then talk about the change agent to others. Father, in this room today, There's probably one, maybe many, who could say to me today, or who would say to you privately, that they need a change. Lord, remind us that we're saved by grace through faith and that not of ourselves. We can't do anything to forward ourselves into the kingdom, save, believe by faith. Lord, there may be somebody here today that feels unworthy or unfit for the kingdom. Lord, remind them, Jesus paid it all. Oh God, I pray now that you'll draw people unto yourself. And as you do, Lord, that you'll change lives. In your precious name I pray. Amen. Brother Michael, lead us in a song of commitment. You can sing along with him, but more importantly, my thought for you is that you'd surrender as we come to this place in the time of worship.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back.
Hey, I want to ask you a question before we sing another verse of that. What was your age when you decided to follow Jesus? You don't have to tell me right now. When did you start following Jesus? When did you sell out to Jesus? Now let's sing this as we really mean it, that you've made a change. And we ain't going to turn back, okay? Sing it as Brother Mike leads us again.
Go with me. Though none go with me, I still will follow. Still will follow, no turning back,
no turning back. Hey, we need to keep our eyes forward, do we not? Because, hey, keep your eyes on Jesus. Let me say thank you for being here. We're soon approaching Easter. Two services every morning, every day. No exception when it comes to Easter. Thank you for your attendance, and we hope we'll have fill the house two times on Easter maybe. Let's pray. Lord, we can't even walk without you holding our hand. And Lord, I can't give anybody help unless you help me with knowledge and wisdom and physical energy to help them. But yet, Lord, help us as we go from this place today to find somebody to lift up the name of Jesus to. Guard our lives, keep us. Thank you for our privilege of being able to assemble together now. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. God bless you.